line up inside that box and try to cut down the passing lanes.
Heineman does a great job coming back and showing. He'll drop it out wide right now. And Franks forgot the ball. It'll go back to Puerto Rico. This game has settled down now after the early goal from Puerto Rico. The Railhawks came charging right back to tie it. So we're at 1-1 before the 10-minute mark. But we've gone the next 10 with not quite the same pace.
We talked about Marco Velez not wanting to let Tom Heineman go, and now the referee's finally seen it. It's just been a battle, grabbing arms, pushing each other around up there the whole game so far. And finally the referee has said, I'm done with this, and you two need to be done with it as well.
Velez.
It's interesting, Dean, the way that Puerto Rico's playing right now. They play like they're playing like they're two goals up, you know, and that sometimes can get a little dangerous. They're just sitting back, letting Carolina bring the game to them, and Carolina's really exposing them in midfield.
Russin will turn. Capone Lowe has come forward. Martinez. Up top, they collide, and Woolard will use his goalkeeper, Eric Reed.
Woolard's done a good job. We know how speedy Kendall Jake Diosin can be, and if he can get around Woolard, he's off to the races against Eric Reed, and Woolard just sacrificed there and was able to keep the ball between him.
Alineo back now. Davidson. Marques Davidson. Franks is now on the left side. Franks comes to get it, plays it back to Russin. As Martinez closed down, Capone Lowe's now come forward. Franks turns to the right though, slides it to Heineman. Lowe is also there.
A good idea there from Franks. Heineman just turned the wrong way, just a little bit off, you know, on a different page there, but Lowe was also coming in that space.
Franks. Boy, you almost want to see it switched right now as Watson is wide open. Barbada will go down, and Marco Velez does not like that call.
Well, and Marco Velez has to be careful if he wants to stay on this pitch, team, because that's the second time the referee talked to him. And yes, maybe Etienne was grabbing his jersey a little bit there, but no one saw him, and they only saw the push from Velez.
So that'll give Paladini and Lowe an opportunity here. This is prime Paladini area. Let's take a look at it here.
You see it, and they're pushing back and forth, but Velez clearly just pushes them right down. Easy call for the referee.
Paladini, part of the league's best 11, which John Bouillet already talked about. Lowe took the last one. You gotta believe they'll leave this one to Paladini. Six-man wall. Paladini will leave it for Lowe. What a fake over the crossbar! Capone Lowe, I like that play, and it almost snuck in.
And what a great idea from Paladini and Lowe. Everyone's expecting Paladini to take this one. The wall is even pushed up a little bit. He runs over it. Lowe just hits it perfectly, just a little bit too high for that post. He had Gaudette beaten. Here you see it again, Dean. Dummies it around. Even the camera thought that Paladini was going to take it.
And Gaudette is in no hurry at all, obviously.
Davidson, Chris, you and David, a step out of the line.
Rustin will let it bounce over his head. And now they'll come back to Reed.
Now Coach Colin Clark calling for high pressure, Dean, from Puerto Rico. So far they've just been sitting back.
They don't see Lowe coming forward as they've been giving Capone Lowe all kinds of space over here. Heineman clipped a little bit, one back by Palladini. Plays it to Franks. Frank stays with it. Hard tackle. They save it off the line. It'll be a throw in, Carolina.
Nice work from Floyd Franks there to get on the inside of Rivera and just get that opportunity, but some good defensive work to pick it up.
Now they switch it to Capone Lowe. He's got Barbata in front of him. That option no longer there. Russin into Heineman, tries to do his own turn. One back by Alenio. Barbara's wide open. Heineman, does Frank see Barbara all the way across? They drop it to Heineman instead. Heineman with a good tackle. Heineman does not stop working. You gotta love watching him play.
Yeah, it actually came to the backside of Heineman. He wanted to receive it on the other foot so he could go forward. He tried to just get on the ground and just tap it back to Capone Lowe, just couldn't get enough of it.
Tied at one. It's the USL D2 Championship. Puerto Rico won the first leg 2-0 down in Puerto Rico. The Railhawks must win by 2 after 90 to force more action. Otherwise, it's the Islanders championship.
You see how high Carolina is playing right now, Dean. The only thing is if that one defender gets beat, there's so much space for Jake Diosing to run behind him.
Watson, as referee lets him play on. Watson drops it over to Barbara. Barbara turned, saw Heineman. He thought Barbara thought he got fouled as well. Russin got kind of pinched under by Jake Dielsing, and Russin will get the call, John.
Yeah, good work from Russin, just kind of claiming the space and going straight up and got the foul on Kendall.
Palladini can't play it. Foul called again on Jake Dielsing. And he's gonna get a warning. And the fans here getting into it at Wake Med Soccer Park. Barely a seat open, John, what a scene.
Oh, this crowd is awesome. Awesome, just what you wanna see for a championship game.
Railhawks. They try to switch it over to Capone Lowe. It'll bounce away from him and it'll come back now to Puerto Rico.
And Puerto Rico just giving Carolina so much space. They just have to be careful with the ball in the midfield to let that ball kind of slip under his foot and go out of bounds and lose possession here. So much great possession for Carolina. They just have to do something with it.
This one will come all the way back. Puerto Rico now on the attack. Be a throw in. To the Islanders. Unbelievable crowd here, John.
Yeah, it certainly is. The supporters have really come out to support the Railhawks like they have all year long, but this place is full.
This is trouble here. Alenio's got to do better with that clearance.
Reed does a good job of just coming out and claiming that one. It was an open ball.
Oh. Palladini, wide right over to Franks. Okay. Franks, right side. Deflected corner kick.
It's interesting when you look, though, Dean, you see the number of orange jerseys in the box compared to white jerseys, and you say to yourself, how is Carolina getting the ball? Maybe two orange jerseys in there, and it's the fight of Tom Heineman and Daniel Palladini. They want this so bad on their home field that they're just not willing to give up.
Capone low, driven in. Alineo sent back across on the head of Russin. No problem for Gaudette.
And that's what you like to see, Bill Gaudette just calling that defense up. And Franks played a beautiful ball right in, and Russin just couldn't get that header down.
Puerto Rico now settling down. Thanks for being with us here at CarolinaRailhawks.com for the U.S. Soccer D2 Championship match. Alineo gets clipped and they'll call the foul. Now they'll quickly play it over to Reed.
Look how wide Carolina are playing Caponolo all the way out here on the touchline.
Palladini comes over in support, plays it right back to Capone Lowe, keeps it alive. Lowe stays with it. Now Lowe feels the pressure, pushed off of it, foul called, and it'll go back to Carolina.
Once again, here comes Brad Russin all the way up for this free kick opportunity. You have Heineman, Russin, and Etienne in the mix as well.
Daniel Palladini. Sent back, sent across, Jake Dielsing. It was Jake Dielsing that kept that first goal alive for Sandy Gabondi, and it was his effort there that keeps the possession to Puerto Rico.
And Woolard did a good job of recovering there, Dean. Jake Dielsing had gotten around Woolard, but he recovered well and got between him and the goal.
Woolard.
Tell you at a pace like this, Dean, there's going to be some substitutes in the second half.
Well, you got Gregory Richardson on the sideline and Josh Gardner, two pretty good weapons to bring off the bench for Martin Rennie. Martin won't be afraid to throw nine attackers out there to try to get those two goals that they need. Palladini was hoping Franks was there. Franks comes in hard, but one back here by Noah Delgado. They'll switch it to Gabondi. He's got Jake Dielsing up in front of him. He's got Foley out wide. He'll use Foley. Martinez in a foot race with Franks. Franks seems to have the edge at the moment. Franks pushed from behind. Referee will let him play on. I'm surprised. Franks can't believe it. Sent back across. Watson will head it out. Gabondi looking for goal number two. Might have it. It's loose, and somehow Eric Reed gobbles it up. Lucky to have that one.
Well, it took a real tough deflection on the way in, and Eric Reed had it covered all the way. Even with the deflection, he had to reach back around his body, and it just popped up right into his breadbasket. I don't know how you don't call the foul though on Martinez.
Heineman gets it out wide to Watson. Need Watson to get going here. Matt Watson coming over. Barbara leaves it for Palladini. Foul, free kick, Carolina, handball.
And I like the trickeration in the first free kick, but I want Palladini on this one, Dean.
Ponolo comes over there with him. You can almost guarantee it's going to be Palladini this time.
In hopes that the referee will give him a clean 10 yards, because that's all Daniel Palladini needs.
Free kick, Daniel Palladini, 24 yards out. Almost center, right down the middle. Can he pick a pocket? Gaudetto punch it, cleared out, over the top.
Well, well struck from Daniel Palladini. It was right at Gaudet, but it was moving a little, so Gaudet elects to punch it. He punches it right back to Franks, and Franks just couldn't keep it down.
Let's take a little look at that one, can't we, boys? Cleared out of bounds. Low. Palladini. Nurse wins it. Looking for Jack Dielsing. Now Willard will play it all the way back to Eric Reed. Reed will bomb it long, trying to find Heineman. Under 10 minutes to go or thereabouts in the first half. Tied at one. Lenio wins it, looks up. Foot race here. Franks finally lets up. Out of bounds, they'll say off of Capone Low. Noah Delgado had it for a second. Now Franks back to Watson. Watson stolen away. Franks with the foul.
And it's getting physical out there, Dean. I mean, you can't even get maybe one touch on the ball before someone's coming in at your ankles.
What do you want to see, John, out of the Railhawks particularly?
Well, you know, the possession has been great. They have the opportunities out there. If they just keep doing what they're doing, the opportunities are going to come. They just have to finish. It's going to be tough to get past Bill Gaudet, but they've shown him already tonight they can.
Willard. Franks, not enough mustard, a little too cute. Can't find Capone Low. Over the top, Jake Dielsing. If he beats Russin, he's in, and Russin boots it into the night.
And that's the only fear. The defense is playing so high, Dean. As soon as that ball gets played in, it's the speed of Jack Dielsing that can get around that defender. Russin does a good job of coming in from that central defender position and just playing the defense.
I bring Heineman back. As Nurse, referee, not quite sure what happened here. a lot of whistles.
Referee's just trying to get everybody out of there.
Colin Clark, fine head coach for the Puerto Rico Islanders. Done an amazing job down in Puerto Rico, also trying to resurrect the national team. This is the shot from Palladini.
Gaudette gets two fists to it, and not a whole lot of space there really for Franks to shoot.
Heinemann saying he got hit in the jaw. And Nurse asking for some help from the linesman.
Heinemann asking for a nurse.
Throw in for the Islanders. Lowe will flick it out of there. Horst keeps it alive to Delgado. He'll take the shot, no problem for Reed. He'll quickly play it out to Franks. Watson is over there far side.
And Franks was looking to get it to him. He just couldn't get it across field.
Not a good pass from Woolard. As Woolard knocks down Jake Dielsing. Franks. Side of his foot, back to Davidson.
It's probably good that Woolard did knock down Jake Dielsing because he was off to the races if not.
Heinemann, this one will squirt through to Palladini. Palladini will send it back across. Barbara's there. Drop to Franks. Franks, can he dial one up? It's got Watson. Watson looking for orange jerseys. Davidson, now back to Lowe. Lowe's got Barbara on his left side. Lowe sends it in. Not really well driven and cleared out of there by Puerto Rico.
And you'd like to see him push a little bit deeper inside that 18 before they play that long ball in there. And Heinemann looks a little shaken up on the play, but that ball just came in and no one else there. Three white jerseys and Tom Heinemann.
Russin comes crashing forward and that makes Puerto Rico knock it out of bounds. They'll quickly play it in to Reed. Railhawks need two goals. They got about 50 minutes to do it. Watson. One back by Franks. And they'll switch it to Capone Lowe. Davidson. They need to find Palladini. And Lowe will come all the way back now to Woolard.
Puerto Rico is really starting to shore up the defense, especially in the midfield. We were exposing them for such a long time, and now that's kind of gone away, and Puerto Rico is shutting up the doors.
Hansen with a nice trap, drops it to Nurse. Nurse too long for Jake Dielsing. Hansen again on the deflection. Foley's got it. Into space to Jake Dielsing. It's 4-on-5 right now, and more white jerseys joining in. Davidson will win it as Rustin stays down for the moment. Now he's up. At the end, Barbara is on it. He'll play it back.
Davidson should have found Heinemann early. He was wide open.
Palladini pushed there by Nurse. Now Barbara down the left side. Brings it back on his right foot. Sends it across, was hoping Heinemann was there, and Heinemann makes a near post run instead of a far post run.
You know, and I think they that first goal was a great goal for the Railhawks, but they're not going to score any more goals like that. These long balls played into the box. There's only one orange jersey of Tom Heineman. You see four or five Puerto Rico Islanders that are just sitting in the box waiting for that ball, and then you have Bill Gaudette. They need to push it further down the field and try to get a runoff or maybe a 1-2.
Here's Lowe, hard tackle. Lowe taken down by Hansen. Palladini wants it. Davidson too strong for Barbada, and Velez will let it roll out of bounds.
If you look there out on the field, Dean, all the passing lanes just completely cut off right now by Puerto Rico, just staying in front of their man in the goal, not letting too much happen, and Carolina just not able to penetrate. It's the same thing that happened in the first game.
Approaching the end of the first 45. We'll have at least a minute or so of added time. Goal celebrations, couple injuries during the first half. Not seen an official word yet, John Bouye.
Yeah, at least a couple of minutes here. And boy, wouldn't it be good for Carolina to get one here in injury time going into halftime. Of course, Josh Hansen's gonna waste as much time as possible, Dean, on the ball.
Sent in by Hansen. 3 minutes of extra time. Sent across, Reed has it. It was Nurse that was able to climb the ladder.
Official has indicated 3 additional minutes of stoppage time in the first half of tonight's match. 3 minutes of stoppage time.
Palladini up top now. Nailed from behind. Not the tallest of player, Palladini. Heineman looking for options. Alenio. As Capone Low makes a run. Woolard runs out of options. Palladini, his left foot, finds Low. Low with a good trap. Low fakes it. Low was hoping to earn a corner kick instead of throw in.
Great touch from Capone Low, and it just closed so quickly by Martinez, he wasn't able to get the ball over for a cross.
This one taken right away, and Watson wins it back. Watson, I guess he was trying to shoot it, but mishit it.
Yeah, and good work there just to win the ball, but Watson just couldn't get his foot or hook his foot around the ball to get it on goal.
This game got off to a raucous start. Puerto Rico scored early, and they've got a decent amount of supporters here in Carolina, but the Railhawks answer just a couple minutes later. Tom Heineman with his fifth goal of the season, answering the goal from Sandy Gabandi, and that's where we sit, but essentially, the scoreboard might as well say Puerto Rico 3, Carolina 1, because that's what we're dealing with, John. That's the story.
Yeah, it's 3-1 on aggregate right now. And Carolina, if they're going to at least force extra time or penalty kicks, need to get 2 goals.
They'll call Watson for the foul that time. Railhawks looking at their bench. They've got Josh Gardner, also have Alan Russell, Gregory Richardson, and they even have Ty Cipollone, who's not played a whole lot, but a dynamic little player.
Yeah, he certainly is. You know, this might be a good game for Gregory Richardson, as he could take players on outside or out wide, and and really just get that ball or force that ball into the 18 a little bit further down. So
let's see if Hansen gets a card here. No more.
Davidson's still down.
Railhawks. Davidson still on the ground. And there's the final whistle. After 45 minutes of play in the U.S. Soccer D2 Championship, Puerto Rico 1, Carolina 1 on aggregate. It's the Islanders with a 2-goal advantage.
Yeah, and a tough first half, a tough way to start. Carolina came out with so much fire, so much passion, aggressive football. You love to see it. And then early on, Puerto Rico was able to, just a great move from Gabondi to get around the Carolina defense and get an early goal for Puerto Rico. On aggregate, it was 3-0 at that point. You thought Carolina's season might be finished. But of course, Tom Heineman jumps certainly high to get past Bill Gaudette. Carolina's only down 2 goals, and they have a whole half to do it, Dean.
Halftime from WakeMed Soccer Park in Cary in front of a near-capacity crowd as the Railhawks have had incredible momentum in the stands the last 5 or 6 games, John.
Yeah, they certainly have. And look at this crowd tonight, Dean. Everybody has come out to support the Carolina Railhawks here for the championship, the quest for the championship, a great season for Carolina. But this crowd tonight, this could be the factor that gets them over the hump.
Dean Linke along with John Bouye. Halftime here, tied at 1. Carolina and Puerto Rico. Goals by Puerto Rico by Sandy Gabondi, and then answered the 5th goal of the season for Tom Heineman, and that's where we stand right now, tied at 1.
Located at 404 West Chatham Street in downtown Cary, the Havana Grill offers the best in Cuban cuisine. Call them for all your catering needs at 919-460-8662 or visit them on the web at www.thehavanagrill.com.
And welcome back here at halftime at WakeMed Soccer Park, where the score, the Carolina Railhawks won. The Puerto Rico Islanders won, of course, on aggregate. It's still 3-1.
Still.
Brian, and really, you know, a lot of emotions going through that first half, a lot of different changes. And, you know, it looked like after Puerto Rico scored that early goal that the season might be over, but Heineman comes back, doesn't he?
Yeah, it's a shame to give up the goal against the run of the play. I don't think Puerto Rico's put more than 2 or maybe 3 passes together going forward in the full first half. We're just killing them. Yeah. This is an absolute domination. And I don't think their strategy is to sit back and get killed. We're just outplaying them badly. And to give up a goal like that, it's a little soft and weak, but it's unfortunate. But Tom got us right back in it. So now we need to find a way to get 2 more goals to extend this game.
Well, and you saw all the space that Puerto Rico was giving us early on, and Colin Clark has seemed to make some changes in the midfield, really not substituting anybody, just moving things around, playing, you know, the forwards playing up a little bit higher and pressuring that defensive back four. There was a lot of space there for Carolina, and it looked like we might even be able to get that second goal. Unfortunately, it didn't come, but has Puerto Rico really just kind of battened down the hatches and said, this is how we're going to play for the rest of the game?
Well, I mean, it took a lot of energy to get, well, we tried to get the first goal, and then we did get a goal, so we used a lot of energy, and naturally the things are going to calm down after 30 or 40 minutes of high pressure and how much the pace we were playing at. And it, you know, they're playing like with a four in the back and then one guy kind of sitting in front of the defense and then 5 midfielders, and they're just kind of still leaving a little bit of space in between their backs and their midfielders. So we just have to find that movement. And, you know, Matt and Danny need to get free, and we're moving our outside guys around a little bit. There's space still. You know, we're so good on the ball that we're always going to create space just because we're so, like, just, you know, technically sound for, you know, of a club. And it's just a matter of finding a little bit of space down the middle of the field. We've missed a few passes when we rotated the field with, you know, Floyd or Matt running through, so we kind of got to get our chin up and, you know, look for that ball that's going to be able to break down the defense. But, you know, again, it's still it's two goals no matter how you look at it. So we got to get one. And I'm sure Martin's saying the same thing right now.
Yep. One at a time.
Let's work on one goal. We've got weapons on the bench. You know, Josh and Greg is over there, and you may see some fresh legs coming in and trying to run at some tired defenders. But again, let's get one goal. We've got 45 minutes. Let's work on the first goal. Then the pressure goes back on them if it's only a one-goal differential. Then get the second goal and possibly look to extend this into extra time.
Well, of course, you know, the Carolina Railhawks here playing for the championship for the first time, and the crowd has come out in droves tonight to support this team. What about the fan support?
Well, it's been great, and we worked late last night putting out some stories thanking the TSF and the new Jailhawks and then just the fans in general. And Martin, you know, had an interview on News 14, and he said, you know, in his own words, the atmosphere has been electric here just in this lead up through the playoffs and the end of the year. And it's, you know, it's basically it's a sold out stadium tonight, and they're behind us and they're chanting and they're banging drums, and they're just like everybody. They're like, okay, let's get one and then we'll go from there.
Well, that's exactly what we need to do, get one and go from there. Brian, hopefully we'll be down on the field celebrating with you here 45 minutes later.
Thank you.
All right, and now we're going to bring in Brian Remedi, the Chief Administrative Officer for the United States Soccer Federation. Brian, how you doing?
Hey, good, thanks. How are you?
So how'd you enjoy the first half?
That was good. It was good. Yeah, it was an entertaining first half. I thought with those two early goals, I thought it was really going to come on a bit more, but I think both teams settled into the game pretty well.
Well, and when you come to a situation where it's, you know, win or go home, or in this situation, if you don't score two goals, then, you know, someone else is going to be celebrating on your field. You can feel that sense of urgency from Carolina.
Absolutely. Both teams have a lot on the line. They put a lot of effort into the season, and I think they're giving it their all right now.
So the Chief Administrative Officer for the USSF, tell us a little bit about your role with the USSF and you coming here.
Yeah, well, my role with the Federation is administrative. So we have our national governing body is based in Chicago. We have approximately 100 total employees. My involvement here is with U.S. Soccer running the Division II league this year. I've done a lot of the work overseeing sort of the administrative side of it. We have a great staff in Chicago, a lot of people fully committed to this, and we, you know, several stakeholders who are very much involved, from marketing to communications to refereeing to finance. We have a lot of people involved in this.
And when you see a team like the Carolina Railhawks, you see the product on the field, you see the fan support. I mean, did you expect seeing this coming into a Division II team, or did you already really know that this is what to expect?
Yeah, well, we knew that Carolina has great fan support here. You could hear it right now, you know, at the halftime. We knew Carolina had great support. It's a great youth soccer community.
Yeah.
The kids love their game, and I think the team and the club have done a very good job making it desirable, putting a good product on the field, and I think you see that tonight.
Yeah. And of course, I'm sure the USSF is busy building that bid for the United States in 2022. How important is that? I mean, we've built our soccer-specific stadiums now. We really have, you know, a great product in the MLS on the field. You know, obviously everyone's saying we have really good chances of getting it, but how important would it be just to the United States in general to get that bid?
Well, if you think about what happened with the 94 World Cup, you know, all the great things that took place after the 94 World Cup with the starting of Major League Soccer, and really the professional game was born again after the 94 World Cup. So to think about us being able to have a World Cup in 2022, a 12-year head start to prepare for the world coming back to the U.S., I mean, the significance is immeasurable. I mean, really, you could think, like, hey, if we're doing this well right now, we can prepare for 12 years for a World Cup. I think we'll be doing really well in 2022.
And, of course, you know, a lot of people, their beliefs are, you know, we need to train the youth here, but then we need to send them out maybe a little bit, you know, to play at a higher level, maybe some of the English leagues, you know, somewhere in Spain. But really now we have these wonderful leagues here in the MLS and, of course, the NASL. I mean, what are your thoughts on that as far as, you know, really getting in those players? I know the United States does a great job of molding those players, but now we actually have a product here that they can learn from.
Yeah, I think the name of the game is taking great youth players and developing them into great senior national team players. You know, for we had some dark years, you know, in the 80s when we didn't have a professional league, for example, where people could, young players could aspire to and prepare their game for. And now we have places to go. And, you know, the most elite players are now considering MLS. And it's not only about starting a professional career abroad, but the key is for our young players, our we call it zone one, these are the youngest of our players, to get quality training to prepare them for the second phase of their development, so that when they reach, you know, when they're reaching 17, 18, 19, 20, they can take their place and have a destination to go to.
And of course, you know, a lot of teams from USL and hopefully now NASL have made that move up to Major League Soccer. Of course, Seattle, the biggest success story so far. You know, you have Vancouver and then Montreal that will make their way into the MLS. I mean, this does seem like a breeding ground, a training ground, just to kind of put that perfect product together. And then once it's there, that's the next step.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, like what we were talking about, I think it's an evolution.
Yeah.
You got to start somewhere. I think what we've seen this year in the Division II is some good quality, a lot of support, and I think that's only going to improve over the years.
Yeah. Well, Brian, we certainly do thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
At halftime, and hopefully we'll be able to put this one out here in the second half.
Right on. Thank you very much.
All right, everybody, we're going to step aside for just a second here at Wake Med Soccer Park, where the score, the Carolina Railhawks won, the Puerto Rico Islanders won on aggregate 3-1, Puerto Rico ahead. We'll be back with first half highlights and the second half in just a little bit.
Tonight's halftime statistics brought to you by Lifetime Fitness. No yellow cards or red cards for either team. Puerto Rico had 4 shots, the Railhawks had 10. In goal department, Puerto Rico 1, Carolina Railhawks 1, an aggregate score for the two-leg D2 championship final. Currently, Puerto Rico leads Carolina 3-1 in aggregate score. This evening's halftime statistics brought to you by Lifetime Fitness, a healthy way of life company. Visit them online at lifetimefitness.com. The Railhawks would like to wish a very special happy birthday to Connor Cheney and Christian Vargas, both celebrating their 12th birthdays at the soccer park this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, the Carolina Railhawks would like to welcome the following groups to Wake Med Stadium this evening. And joining the game tonight are all scripts: the Castle Boys U-12 Classic Team, the Cotswold Neighborhood, Sanford Sharks, Red Hat, Triangle Football Club 97 Navy, the 98 Strikers from the Triangle Football Club, and the TFC Triangle Development Academy. We'd like to thank our groups for coming out to enjoy the game this evening, and for all of you for attending tonight's D2 championship between the Puerto Rico Islanders and your Carolina Railhawks.
Yeah.
fans coming back out on the field. The Puerto Rico Islanders and your Carolina Railhawks. It's United States Soccer D2 Championship Finals tonight. The second leg of the two-leg final between the Railhawks and the Islanders. Pretty full stadium tonight. We have Section 204, the Triangle Soccer Fanatics down there making some noise. Got the Jailbirds over in 307 making their noise. The great fans from Puerto Rico, let's all make some noise. Up on your feet, make some noise as the team start the second half. How about it, Orange? How about your Carolina Railhawks?
Down on the field presenting the sponsors of the Carolina Railhawks, a very special presentation. Their unbelievable support here for Carolina. Let's see if we can take a look here at the Puerto Rico goal in the first half.
And there you see it early on, Sandy Gabandi. Some good footwork there, lays it off to Foley. It gets into Jagdeos thing, he holds up the ball and kind of pushes over there. Gabandi does a good job of getting around the sliding tackle of Russin and just hammers it into the corner right underneath Eric Reed.
That was the first goal. Let's see if we can find the equalizer by the Carolina Railhawks as we get ready to start the second half. How soon before Martin Rennie goes to his bench to try to get those goals, John, as we're underway here in the second half?
Well, I think you have to look at it here pretty quickly. I mean, now everyone's a little rested, so maybe those legs are fresh again, but if it doesn't change, it might have to make changes.
...45 minutes away from crowning a champion, unless Carolina can come up with two goals and force added time here. Keep in mind, last week, Puerto Rico beat Carolina 2-0 down in Puerto Rico. Thus, the aggregate right now, 3-1 Islanders.
Carolina started so strong in the first half, Dean, and they have to have that same mentality coming out here in the second half. Push everything up on Puerto Rico, play that high line, and just go for it.
Heineman, boy, he never stops working.
No, he certainly doesn't. It looked like he tripped Josh Hansen. It was right in front of the referee, and he didn't call it.
Palladini. Out wide to Capone low, got clipped a little bit. Watson, Alineo, diagonal ball. Ooh, and Watson gets knocked to the ground. Now a yellow card's going to come out on Hansen.
And Hansen's been warned a couple times so far, Dean. He gets those elbows up right in the face there. And looked like Watson caught one. The referee's seen enough, and he's in the books. First one. We've seen Palladini hit him from here, Dean.
Pretty close, huh? A big win against Miami. Couple years ago, Palladini loops it over, but this one he completely mishit, John.
Especially when you have the heads of Brad Russin and Tom Heineman up there, and you just want to get some service that they can do something with, and fortunately that one went over the end line. I think one thing that Martin Rennie would say early on, Dean, is when he went into halftime, is that every pass is important. If that ball, you make a mistake here in the field, then someone's down.
Barbara got hit pretty hard, and Heineman immediately calling for the bench.
Fans, don't forget to get your championship t-shirts in the West Concourse this evening.
And now Heineman's waving him off, so. Maybe in the back of the head. Now it looks like, but as we were saying before, every pass is so important. You can't give the ball away in the midfield. And Carolina, right towards the end of that first half, was just giving the ball away, letting the ball just fall over their foot, going out of bounds, losing possession. They cannot afford to do that here in the second half.
sent out of bounds. Throw in back to Carolina. Puerto Rico, rather. This is dangerous. And Alenio sends it away. Corner kick, Islanders.
And good work from Alenio, because we've seen those own goals come very easily from a play like that. He's with his back in front of the goal there. He's turning around trying to clear the ball out, but it's almost a shot on your own goal trying to clear it off that line.
Hansen, who just got the yellow, will handle the corner. Driven in. Linio clears it. Delgado in a foot race with Franks. Rivera can't handle it. Watson will try to close it down. And this one will go out of bounds. At what point do you see the urgency, John?
Well, I think right now Carolina's doing a good job of possessing the ball. The passes are there. I mean, if that's at a certain point, you're not getting the quality opportunities on goal, then you have to make a change. But give these guys a little more time, Dean.
No whistle. Rivera wanted one, stays with Carolina. Here's Watson. Pono low, keeps it in. Palladini. See, John, the possession's not really been there the way it was in the first half.
Well, they're getting the passes through the midfield, but they're just not getting any further than that, and Puerto Rico's doing a good job of cutting off the passing lanes. Right there, Palladini had Etienne making a nice run, but Hansen stepped in and blocked it.
The Islanders settle. Hansen over the top, looking for Jack Dielsing. He can turn, folks. It's Russin with the deflection. Kept alive, and Alenio sends it deep.
And a little too deep there. And that dangerous Jack Dielsing who's going to get around you, and Russin's doing a good job of just keeping him in front of him. He turned there and just was able to get his foot in on the volley.
Knocked out of bounds by Lowe, back to Puerto Rico. 7 minutes into the second half, the Railhawks, Puerto Rico tied at one. Railhawks down 2 goals in aggregate for the U.S. Soccer Division II Championship. Here's the goal scorer for the Islanders, Gamondi. Foley dummied it, was hoping it would go through. Now Palladini tries to play it up top.
And not very good passing from Carolina here, especially right there. The bad ball from Daniel Palladini, and Carolina recovers, though.
Heineman wins it. Now they'll give the call back to Heineman.
And they tried to play that one through the midfield.
Barbara. Rivera shields him off. Referee lets him play. Delgado goes down.
Russin just got a piece of him, and you see how quick this game is being played through the midfield. If you hang on the ball for too long, you're either going to get your legs taken out from under you or you're going to lose possession.
Gabondi to Delgado. Delgado sends it in. And Eric Reed has it.
Yeah, an easy save for Eric Reed. Gabondi just, or excuse me, Jake Dio's thing, just let that one slide. Delgado hit it well, but right at Eric Reed.
Boy, Franks has got to turn the other way. Alenio's wide open.
Yeah, Alenio's screaming for the ball here on the wing, and they just can't get it to him.
Foley over to Hansen. Hard foul. Capone Lowe comes in. He might get a card. So Lowe is in the books.
Lowe definitely clipped him, but every time a Islander goes down, Dean, they're going to stay down for a little while longer. Just that much closer to a championship. No one off the bench for the Railhawks yet.
Clock keeps moving at the moment. John Bouye, Dean Linke, delighted to be with you here as we roll on in the second half of the U.S. Soccer D2 Championship game. Currently